second part for the eulogy and the tribute.
Good. Good afternoon, church. God is good. And all the time. Changamken kidogo. We are here to celebrate the life of our hero. And I'm going to take you through this a part of tribute and other aspect. Our bishop, your excellency, our deputy president, and all protocols observed. This part, we will start with the eulogy, which will be read jointly by the two sons, Patrick Wamai and Jimmy Mwangi Matu. Please come forward.
Good afternoon, church. We read the eulogy of our father, me and my brother. We'll go in turns. So start. Childhood. Elliot Matu Wamai, EBS Matu, was born at Kiroya Hospital on Wednesday, the 14th of July, 1937. His parents were the late Patrick Wamai Kirosho and the late Anastasia Wambura Wamai. Matu was a sixth-born child out of 12. Eight survived to grow into adults, namely Wajiro Peter Matheri, the late Esther Gadiga Jogu, Matu himself, the late David Maranga Wamai, Mary Wago Nanga, Paul Matheri Wamai, Joyce Gadoni Kiarie, and Dr. Humphrey Maina Wamai. Matu was raised by his parents in Kyujuge, Kenyange village, Aikoyo sublocation, Magutu location, Madera, Nyeri County. Their homestead had three houses. The first, his mother and two of his sisters, Wago and Gadoni. Maina was a baby then. The kitchen was in this house. The second house served as his father's bedroom, and he shared with Matu and his two younger brothers. All three brothers slept on a bed across from their father's bed, and the youngest sleeping in between his elder siblings to save him from falling off the bed at night. The floor space was occupied by goats and sheep, with a fireplace right in the middle of the house. The fire kept the house warm, and when it burnt out, the body heat of the livestock provided the warmth. It was around the fire, and around the fire were gods of beer, were fermenting when it arises. The third house was for the two eldest daughters, where one was occasionally see young men visit for a chat and then depart. There were two granules. On the west of the house compound was a bush. The northwestern side was a cattle paddock. The southern side was a kitchen garden. And the southwestern side was a fence with a gate, which was called Muhiriga, at the home entrance or exit. During Matu's youth, the environment in Magutu was the healthiest that anybody could desire. The air cool and clean, with regular seasons of sufficient rain and sunshine. All rivers ran clean water. The soil was fertile, and there was enough food for all. Matu's work was herding cattle, sheep, and goats. The land around was sparsely populated, and the distance separating the houses was spacious. There was large pastures intercepted by bushlands, and it was not unusual to encounter predators or wild herbivorous animals. Matu and other herd boys worked throughout the day, no lunchtime, as the livestock left in the morning and returned home in the evening and need constant vigilant care. Family. On 28th September 1963, Matu was joined in matrimony to his fiancée, Jace Gadoni Mohori, a school teacher. The couple begot four children, all boys. Patrick Wamai Matu, that's me, the late Stephen Mohori, James Mwangi, here, and the late Michael Matu. He was the father-in-law to Alice Washera, Winrose, Wajiro Kirima, and grandfather to Michelle Wamai, Gregory Matu, Stephanie Matu, Andrew Matu, Zoe Mombi, Matu Jeff, Maya Wajiro, Farah Gadoni, and great grandfather to Andre Wamai.
Education. In 1946, Matu started schooling at Magutu Lower Primary School. There were no nursery schools at that time in the locality, and primary education ended at standard 6. Matu passed the primary level national examinations and was admitted to the then Kiremara Intermediate School, where he sat and excelled in his national examination. In 1954, he joined Kagumo High School. In 1957, he sat for the Cambridge Overseas Certificate of Education and passed with good grades, and soon thereafter went to Nairobi to look for employment while looking for opportunities to further his education. He was not among the small number of students who were admitted to Makerere University, which at that time was the only university in East Africa. After a short stay in Nairobi, this enterprising young man got a job at British American Tobacco, where he worked for a while before applying for a better paying job at Esso Petroleum Company. It was while working at Esso that he saw a Government of India advertisement to study at the University of Delhi in India on a full scholarship. He applied, attended the interview, which he passed, and was offered the scholarship, a welcome opportunity to advance his education. And when news of his admission to study overseas reached Magutu, there was excitement all around. It was hot news. A harambe to raise his upkeep was convened by the local education officers and the administration officials. And the attendees contributed generously. A total sum of 10,000 shillings was raised. That was a substantial amount then. Today, that would be more than 1 million shillings. In mid-1959, an excited and cheering crowd waved as Matu boarded the train at Karatina Railway Station for his trip to Mombasa via Nairobi. From Mombasa, he traveled by steamship to Bombay, today called Mumbai, in India. From Bombay, he traveled by train to the University of Delhi in New Delhi. He enrolled for a Bachelor of Commerce degree. In 1962, he graduated and returned to Kenya to serve his people.
Working life. When Matu returned to Kenya, jobs were available for the higher educated Africans. He was soon employed as an auditor of the East African Railways and Harbors Corporation. Shortly after, he was appointed the auditor director of the East African Common Services. When Central Bank of Kenya, CBK, was established in 1966, he became its first general manager. He worked for the CBK for about 3 years before moving up the ladder to his next appointment after a competitive interview. In December 1969, he became the executive director of ICDC. Matu worked with passion and dedication and developed ICDC into an institution that was recognized and respected by all Kenyans, particularly businessmen in trade and industry. ICDC lent money for capital and expansion to many African entrepreneurs. It was ICDC and KNTC that enabled indigenous Kenyans to buy out foreign and non-African owned businesses. The process was called Africanization. It was during Matu's tenure at ICDC that the corporation built Uchumi House. Matu worked in ICDC for approximately 10 years. Matu was appointed the chairman of the new KCC by President Kibaki. He dedicatedly worked hard to resurrect and develop a corporation that had literally died, and the carcass had become the meal for those who had bought the original KCC. Through his leadership, the new KCC grew into a strong corporation that we see today. As he has stated in his autobiography, Born to Serve, which is currently available in bookshops, it provides a livelihood of many farmers. Consequently, there's no need for state more on this. Until his passing, Matt was the chairman of Agricultural and Industrial Holdings Limited, a position he took over from the late Honorable Jenga Karume. Under his stewardship, the corporation prospered and continued to earn dividends for its members and building along Moy Avenue and other properties. Matu was an entrepreneur businessman. He was the chairman of Gong Hills Hotel and was also instrumental in the expansion of and growth of other businesses.
Politics. Matu resigned from ICDC in 1979 to contest the parliamentary election for Madeira constituency, right here where we are. He receives support from the majority of the councillors, businessmen, and other influential inhabitants of the constituency. He waged a vigorous electoral campaign, which he unfortunately lost to the late Davidson Giboine Kuoro. He contested the next election in 1983 and won with a comfortable margin. After losing the 1987-88 Mulolongo election, he returned to attend to his businesses. He made a comeback in the 1992 elections and won comfortably and successfully defended his seat in the next election of 1997. In 2002, after losing, he decided to retire from politics. During his three terms as a Member of Parliament, he served the people of Madeira and Kenya in general with utmost commitment. He organized the building of many classrooms and some bridges. He actively participated in parliamentary debates, as he has so well described in his book. Matu actively participated in the constitutional reform movement, which brought about the current constitution.
Illness. Matu's health started declining from 2015. He continued to receive the best treatment available locally, which was administered by competent, dedicated doctors. But as fate would have it, he also suffered from some other illnesses, most of which were successfully treated. Unfortunately, at time of passing, he had to use a wheelchair, and although he fought it out, he was in and out of the hospital. His beloved wife, Joyce, stood by his side throughout until his death on Wednesday, the 14th of December, 2022. The family of Matu's siblings, relatives, will forever be grateful towards Joyce, our mother, for her unfailing love for her husband. They are also grateful for the doctors who kept Matu going about his affairs despite his indisposition, and are grateful to the many friends who went to Matu's home to comfort the family. It is the Almighty God who brought Matu to this world, and it is Him who has called him. May his soul rest in eternal peace. Amen. Thank you all.
Thank you, Patrick Jimmy. Now we go to family tributes, and they will line as follows. Mrs. Nyamo will do the tribute for Mama Omai, then followed by tribute from the two children, Patrick and Jimmy, then followed by grandchildren led by Michelle. So please get ready. Start with Mrs. Omai. Welcome.
The Most Reverend Peter Kairo, Emeritus Bishop of Nyeri, His Excellency the Deputy President of the Republic of Kenya, Mr. Gachagua. Good afternoon to everybody else. Good afternoon, Church. Can you wave like this? Because we are celebrating a life of an honorable person. My name is Agnes Nyamu. I'm going to read the tribute on behalf of Mrs. Joyce Wamai, the wife of the late Honorable Matu. And here I read. Matu was my partner for almost 60 years. We loved to travel as a family. Through him, I got to know the country because his job at ICDC required him to travel across Kenya. We always traveled together as a family, and he never left us at home. He always encouraged us and supported me in my pursuit of education, my career, and my businesses, as he did to my children, because freedom was very important to me. Our house was always open, and many members of our family lived with us throughout the years in our home. He was a very loving and very jovial husband and father, and he loved dancing. That was a good tribute. He loved to hold the Christmas parties for the Gong Hills customers and staff, together with the other family members. Even though tough times came around, and when he became unwell, he was still jovial and very courageous. He never complained of his pain. I thank God that he is finally at rest after struggling 7 years with various ailments. My beloved lived a good life. He loved life. He loved the family, and he has left a legacy. May the angels of the Lord receive you. Goodbye to my friend, my beloved husband, and father of my children, until we meet again. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. Eternal rest grant unto Eliud, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. Fare thee well, my beloved husband, till we meet again. Amen.
Good afternoon again, church. This is my tribute to my father. I cannot begin to imagine not having you, Dad, on the end of the phone or popping around at the moment's notice to assist or air your views on an issue. I've worked with you closely and gracefully for 38 years. I've celebrated with you every success, great or small. Our relationship moved from father, son, to best friends. You have been the greatest cheerleader for me and my family. Thank you for being there to celebrate every milestone that my children have gone through. Dad was hardworking, compassionate towards everyone, and deserved the success and accolades that he enjoyed. He taught me many, many things, but I think most importantly, he gave us the ability to know that if you really put your mind into something, success becomes obvious. And never to be afraid to give anything a go. His attention to detail and perfection was infectious, and once in a while, it would get me into trouble with him. He was a very clever and humorous man, who was never afraid of having a good laugh when the moments called for it. His passion for investment and service to people in his retirement gave him many happy hours despite his failing health. Dad was incredibly practical and bubbly with creative ideas, and we are so lucky that he passed on so much of his knowledge and skills to us. Rest in peace, Papa. Lastly, I am deeply humbled by Mom's strength over the last few years, for a few days, and her ability to focus on the amazing life she shared with my dad and not dwell on what she has lost. I hope that through this, I can find strength from her example and be there whenever she needs me. Thank you, Church.
Your Eminence, Bishop Emeritus Peter Cairo, we're in your home now.